It's always a great pleasure for African Ascent to continue drawing from the resources, imaginations, passions, and talents of both the faculty and also the student population. As my viewers know, as I always say, thousands of you, African Ascent has been bringing you both emerging young artists, either in the beginning or in the middle of their student careers, but also the stellar faculty who teach them, who shape and sculpt them. My guest this evening is a student that I was quite lucky to have discovered about 2 years ago in my ethics course, in which she undoubtedly emerged as one of the two best students that I have had the honor to teach there. So impressed I was by her that I encouraged her to consider minoring in philosophy. You might be surprised, but there is a minor in philosophy at Berklee College of Music. She readily agreed and became a philosophy minor. And then she, on her own, decided to take another foundational course that I teach, of which I am very proud, called African/Africana Philosophy, in which she is now a student, and need I say, for the second time, excelling brilliantly. Emily Estefan is African Ascent's guest tonight. And before she begins treating her to her music, I thought that we would have some acquaintance of interviewing one another for the next 25 minutes or so. Welcome to African Ascent.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
It's a pleasure. Well, in your case, from the fact that you're my student at Berklee College of Music, I have come to learn a few things about you. You are quite modest for your age, I think. Very modest indeed. Unassuming, but also very meticulous in what you do. Very hardworking. I wonder what the background to this talent is as you assess yourself, like most of us do, although not all of us assess ourselves, but I think you do that. I have noticed. How did you get to develop these talents that, in my judgment, are marks of success?
Oh, wow, thank you. Well, to begin, assessing myself is a flaw of mine, which some may see as perhaps not being a flaw. I do, because it has prohibited me in the past from excelling to my full potential. It's very recently that I've began to use that as something to aid me in my flourishing. Before, it was a big advocate for ceasing everything that I was trying to excel. For example, I am a drum set principal at Berklee, and probably around now I'm playing at least, which is okay because the environment that I've been able to be in, including your courses, have allowed me to push out some things out of the way that have been blocking me from accessing my full potential. Writing, singing, guitar, opening my horizons. As far as before, when I was younger, I come from a family of musicians, famous musicians, and they are the opposite of what society would think they would be. And by being nurtured in such an environment where it's very key to be very grounded, very on the same page with everyone, I couldn't help but grow up being modest because even the best of the best were being modest, so that was quite the blueprint for me. I can't see it any other way. Ego is not an option, it doesn't help, and we learn until we die, so we need to keep that attitude, I think.
And as far as you could recall, at what point in your discovery of music did you experience that aha moment and you said to yourself, I want to play like that? you must have seen a certain musician, maybe, or you must have listened to certain genres, or you must have somehow been enveloped, should we say, by a household musical culture, or a combination of all three.
Yeah.
That must have somehow contributed to you, to, among other things, give us at Berklee College of Music an opportunity to be your teachers.
Well, to be honest, the aha moment didn't come until very recently, very, very recently, and it was alone with myself in a very empty, not empty in the sense of lonely, empty in the sense of the energy waves were very clean. It was very late at night. I can literally pinpoint it down to a moment. But as far as what led to that, all of the things that you listed are accurate. My household, you know, always musical, always exceptional musicians, always wanting to be where they were. All of the shows that I've seen from when I was very, very young until now, exceptional musicians. And even the shows, I found that even the shows that you go to that may not resonate very much with you, push you even harder because you know how you don't want to be. And that's equally as important for a musician. You know, oh, well, you know, that's not the genre for me, at least I know now, et cetera. As far as that moment, it came my first semester here in a snowstorm.
Wow.
Locked up in my apartment all by myself, about 3:30 in the morning, holding my guitar, and I said, wow, you know, it's amazing how such a powerful moment could arise from such a lonely one, from such a dark one. And from then I realized just how, I mean, I'd seen it my entire life, how powerful writing was, but to myself, something clicked. I need to write, I need to say what I want to say, I need to get it across. And from then on, I used to be very nervous. Dropped that, I dropped anything except for just you got to be yourself and just get yourself out there, what you want to say.
Additionally to Roger Brown, our president rarely fails to mention humorously to me when he says, Tedros, if you can make musicians be interested in philosophy, mm-hmm. then you must be doing something right. I wonder what he means. Why is it so difficult, do you think, for musicians to take something like philosophy, which is really about thinking systematically, reflecting, and coming to the conclusion after self-assessment that the reflective life, the systematic life, is simply good for you as a human being. That is what philosophy means to me. That's why I chose to practice that style of existence very much like you when I experienced that aha moment. Mm-hmm. But most people think that philosophy, defined in that particular way, might not interest artists, particularly musicians, which strikes me as profoundly incorrect.
Very.
And stereotypical.
Yes. The reason I believe why that occurs is two. A, there is a population at Berklee who wants to focus on music and they have a closed-minded mentality. However, maybe they may be overlooking the fact that music has a lot of components, one of which is what you're trying to accomplish with your music. And to do that and to assess that, you need to nurture all aspects of your education. Personally, I believe that. That's where, you know, there's a split. I come across a lot of students who have a negative connotation about the liberal arts that we are required to take at Berklee. And granted, I think that maybe they should be more self-directed. That's the way in which I found philosophy. It's not at all required. I was interested, and from that a seed was born, and I'm getting very many liberal arts in. I think maybe if it were more of a choice as, you know, which direction, then maybe more people would discover it. When it comes to philosophy itself in music, I think it is of the utmost importance because we need to assess the past and where we've come as a society, where we're going, how what we think about that, whether we want to talk about it or not. And then also philosophy has to offer many things for the self. And when you nurture the self, then you can have a great product. So I think that I wish that everybody had to go through that cycle. I guarantee that it would make more well-rounded, better musicians.
I see. And correct me if I'm wrong. Again, very much like you observe me as your teacher and your friend, I also observe you very carefully. I must, so that I can serve you best as a teacher. And one observation that I have of you is that you're not very happy with the world as it is, from the hints that I get from you in our classroom discussions. And correct me again if I'm wrong, from which it follows that you may be thinking about using music, certain dimensions of it, to make this world, this place, less miserable.
That is correct, what you said. I focus on I love to write about, there's a lot of beauty in this world, there's a lot of love, a lot of light. It's around me, I'm blessed. However, others, many others, are not living in this beautiful, blissful life. What angers me is the ignorance of some of these subjects, the overlooking of some of these. And I would love to bring those to attention in a form where people can more easily access them. Some people aren't curious enough to do research, which it's a free world, you know, we can do whatever we want. But if we make it accessible in a way that can at least trigger, you know, some thinking, that's great. We need to move past many issues. And meanwhile, you know, keeping in mind that there is beauty in this world.
In our Africana philosophy course, for example, in which you are critically present and very hardworking, I appreciate the literature that you're consuming, because I'm giving you so much literature.
It's amazing.
And what you have learned, from what I have learned from you, as you summarize some of the readings, is that the unquestioned idea that what we call philosophy originated in Athens in 500 BC, when measured and judged by the alternative argument that what we call philosophy, as a matter of fact, originated about 2,500 BC in ancient Egypt, to which some of the major Athenian and non-Athenian philosophers, including Plato himself, Aristotle, Socrates, Pythagoras, Thales, Anaxagoras, the list is quite long, themselves admit that what we call philosophy, which I have conceived as a systematic and reflective activity in the form of thinking, originated in the hands of Egyptian priests, to whom these Greek philosophers went, from whom they learned, and then proudly declared when they returned to Athens that they learned this activity called philosophy for the first time. Mm-hmm. And then they give it a Greek and Athenian historical shape because of the geographic location of Athens. Mm-hmm. Athens is not in Egypt. Athens was in Athens, so forth and so on. And since then, we have come to see the flourishing and development of not philosophy per se, but Western philosophy. Mm-hmm. You're now reading this literature, mastering it and understanding it. How do you think could this information that the world has been systematically prevented from knowing be communicated musically?
Well, I believe that if more people went in detail as we do in class, the world would change right away. Because there is a scratching on the surface that we can apply with music that can entice further research. That's what I'm hoping to do. I'm not going to, you know, have my lyrics be so complex and so coded that people will just be like, what is this? That's not the goal. My goal, personally, is to take this information and put it in a way where it will definitely make someone go, well, maybe I don't know enough about that. You know, later on, I'll be performing a song that I wrote a couple days ago, inspired by just a class a couple weeks ago of ours. And learning about this and reading about it really makes you feel so excited to have people know that. It's such a conversation topic. Anytime I have a moment, I'm like, oh, look what I learned the other day. You wouldn't believe, you know, the extent of how much has been buried of information. And not only, you know, in literature, because, well, people can say, well, literature, you know, that can be changed, that can be false. Yeah, but science can't. And we studied scientifically also the origins of how of mankind was originated in Africa and went on from there. So it's very scientific and very real. And if you don't choose to believe that, you can choose to believe literature. And if you don't choose to be that, you can believe the portrait of the philosopher, which then the Buddha was... assume that it was structured after, if you put the images side by side. It's amazing that the things that we can find.
The image of that Egyptian philosopher that we looked at, who looks very much like our image of the Buddha, who is sitting and looking at the stars, and the distinguishing characteristics of whom, according to that ancient Egyptian text, is reflectiveness, deliberateness, control of the passions, curiosity about texts and other cultures, modesty, actively looking for a transcendental force outside of one's body. And this portrait was given to the Egyptians, Plato, chiefly Plato, among whom that becomes the subject matter of parts of Book 4 and definitely the whole section on Book 6 of Plato's major work, The Republic. We uncover this text and this portrait of the philosopher from an ancient Egyptian text. And when I first heard it, it blew my mind, and it even blows my mind more when I share it with curious students such as you, hoping and thinking that it will be corrected, refined, honed, and shared with the world, because that portrait belongs to all of us. Yes. It's only a geographical accident that it originated in Egypt. From there, it becomes a dynamic and living part of the history of the human species. So I am thrilled, I have to be honest with you, that I have a curious student such as you, and all those six or seven others who are in that class, very precious students. I handpicked them, by the way, you're one of them. And I'm hoping that this literature, as you say, will somehow become communicated and shared with the world by musicians. Because as I always say, very few are interested in philosophy and its boring and pretentious vocabulary. Whereas every human being is potentially interested in music. That's why I think artists in general and musicians in particular could share this piece of information with the world, as you are about to. Which brings me now to discuss you and your passion for writing, for writing songs. How do you do it? Is it very difficult to write songs? It must be.
Inspiration is key for me. However, we just had a conversation about inspiration. And I think, you know, something that I think that my mother implemented to me is that boredom does not exist. And if you take that concept further, which I do often, because you know when you're a little kid, you're like, oh, mom, I'm bored. Can't do that, because boredom to me does not exist. If you have a mind, if you have the ability to live, you cannot be bored. You have too much to think about, too much to do, too much to offer. With that being said, that invited to me the concept of thinking about what I wanted to get out there, whether it be a self-struggle, whether it be a funny story that I made up, that I translated in the form of writing, or whether that be something that I really want people to listen to. I go from there. I think of a central idea. With that in mind, I have a very specific vocabulary in my writing, like a certain style that's a little, I don't want to say aggressive, but I have something to say to you. I want you to listen. So it comes across in my writing. And that's not a good thing or a bad thing. It depends on who the listener is. But I approach the music and the lyrics a very different way, equally with as much attention, because I think they're equally as important. And when they are married justly, then the point is even better placed across.
How do you choose the right word musically to communicate a particular emotion? How is that done? I have always wondered how songwriters do it.
Well, funny story about this, actually. Once again, a tune that I will be playing for you today, brand new. I usually can finagle my way around finding a word when I have an emotion. I have a thesaurus, you know, your research, et cetera, whatnot. But I got to this one spot, and I wanted to say something that I should not say, something very full of anger that I knew that I shouldn't say. It's a better way of communicating, but I did not know. Not only am I also stubborn often in my writing. I called my mother. I said, Mom, you know, I'm really struggling. I really want to be angry here. I want people to know I'm angry, but I don't, you know, I don't want to be vile or whatnot. She said, there's no need to use words, you know, that are unnecessary. There's always another word waiting to be discovered by you. And I'm like, oh, well, what is it? And she's like, well, I'm not going to tell you. She's like, you need to go find it yourself. You need to do the just searching inward and outward. And when you find it, you will find it and it will be right. When you do not second guess it, it is correct. It is the right word. And often it takes days to find one word. Hmm. Days.
Don't you get bored to hunt down words?
No,
particularly when you feel inspired, Emily, sometimes this happens to me a lot as a writer. I have a tendency to fall in love with anything that I write, which is a function of the fact that I'm not a good writer.
Oh, please.
If I was a good writer, as all good writers say, I shouldn't be liking what I'm putting down. In fact, I should be burning it. But this has never happened to me. I wonder why. Something must be wrong with me, I think.
No, I don't think so.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm positive.
Yeah, but contrast that with you, for example.
Oh.
Who hunted down a word for 3 hours, whereas I could have picked it and put it down in a second.
Well,
this leads me to shame.
No. What happens next is the interesting part. When I finish, I want nothing more to do with it.
I see.
As you mentioned. I spend all this time getting it to where I want to be. I put all this effort. I stay up nights. Last semester, I stayed up 2 straight days finishing a song without sleeping. And when I'm done, I'm done. Like, that's it. Unless it's a live situation where I get to tell my story.
Yes.
I never listen to my songs again. I never read my lyrics again. When it's a complete thought, it's complete and it's done and it's out of me until it's time to perform.
It is amazing. Well, the interview has hardly begun. I have so many things that I want to ask you about, but we only have 3 minutes left, which means that this interview is only the beginning of a friendship with African accent.
Nice.
That you'll come back at least once a year
to
visit with us. It has been such a pleasure to talk to you, and I apologize for speaking so profusely.
Oh, no.
I did not mean to.
Not at all.
I thought that I had enough time to get into further details. I haven't, We have about a minute and a half left. What would you like to say? 2 minutes left. What would you like to say to your colleagues tonight about music?
Well, first off, I would like to thank you and everybody for having me. It's an honor. Secondly, I would like to invite all of my colleagues and everybody, whatever your profession, to go and learn things about the world. Learn things about where we came from, about where we're going. Don't just idly cruise through life. That's not why we're here. We're here to take what has happened and what will and make it something and learn about ourselves. And I think that with every profession, we can be better human beings by just learning. And philosophy is a great outlet for that. So, everybody.
And how many songs are you going to play for African Accent tonight?
I'm going to do four.
Four songs. And they're going to take about 25 minutes or so, you think?
A little bit less.
Yeah. If you have time, I would like you to pause between the songs and tell us about the songs.
Of course.
Because you're also going to play, I think, a song by the great Emily and the great mother.
Yes.
The Gloria Estefan.
Yes.
And the Emilio Estefan. You're going to do a song by your mother, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. So you might want to say something about that when we get there.
Of course.
Well, we're about to take a break. It has been a pleasure introducing Emily Estefan, my very student at Berklee College of Music, of whom I'm very proud. Thanks for staying with us.
In 1990, in Severn, Maryland, the daughter of a clergyman was discovered by a music industry insider while pumping gas at a service station. The odds of her getting signed and spending 11 weeks at number one on the U.S. singles charts? 1 in 19 million. The odds of this former church choir singer going on to sell 40 million records, 1 in 15 million. The odds of the same woman winning 6 Grammy Awards and starring in 2 Broadway plays, 1 in 75 million. The odds of this musician and performer having a child diagnosed with autism, 1 in 88. I'm Toni Braxton. And I encourage you to learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs. Early diagnosis can make a lifetime of difference.
Oh, those boys are much too much. Those boys are much too much. We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We're gonna beat them and bust them.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call or visit fatherhood.gov to learn more.
Look at me. Hey.
Raymond, look at mommy.
Maybe the light hurts his eyes.
Maybe she's just not hungry.
Maybe he can't hear us.
Maybe we're not stimulating him enough. Maybe it's a phase.
Avoiding eye contact is one early sign of autism. Learn the others today. The sooner it's diagnosed, the better.
This is the moment I knew. His future had no boundaries.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
So this first song that I'm going to perform is an original, which I wrote about, I want to say, a year ago. And it's very much about, briefly, what we touched upon of being born into a situation where you feel like you have some kind of royalty, whether that be literal royalty or musical royalty, whatnot. So I developed this idea with the concept of the name of the song, which is called Purple Money. Purple represents royalty in very many cultures and whatnot. And money I used as a term to tie in the aspect of the riches in whatever sense they may be. I hope you guys enjoy it. It's called Purple Money. Here it is. Pick your poison coins of eight. Copper compost doesn't flow well through your porcelain. Grew from a flower whose seed was a dime. Sinners don't play cowards in your paradise. Purple money. Oh, purple money. Yeah, 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 yeah. Purple money. Purple money. Writing books on who won wars. Paper paid the answer for the curious souls. Playing with the pieces of a broken game. You can claim your victory, tell me your last name. Purple money. Oh, purple money. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Purple money. Purple money. Keep believing it's the way. Rich with power, but they'll pay. Forward thinkers burn the tree. Wrapped again by violet leaves. Purple money. Purple money. Oh, purple money. Oh, purple. Purple money. Money. Purple money. Purple money. Purple money. This next song, very important to me, by my mother. It's called Path of the Right Love, and special for many reasons. First off, she came to visit a little while back and came to one of the professor's philosophy courses in which we were talking about the power of communicating through the music itself, and she brought up one of her tunes, which is the one I'm about to sing. And it's about choosing the right way to direct your love and in which manner. Very important to me. Path of the Right Love. Check it out, guys. Love, 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 love. I say the words so very loosely. Where we come from is love, 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 pure love. We're on our way back home, and on that way, you never look back. Come on. Cause there's nothing there to see, just look around you. There's always someone that's in need of maybe just kindness. As we watch each other bleed from wounds we choose, we'll never lose. Love, 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 love. Misunderstood yet so desired. We pay the cost for love, love, love. But we get back so much more. Oh, so much more. So many questions beginning to unfold. That look for the answers. In the middle of my soul, I know you're out there. And it's not like I've been told, so I run to you. No, I run to you to find the path of the right love. Oh, yeah, yeah, the path of the right love. Oh, I found the path of the one love. Oh, yeah, the path of the right love. Love, 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 love. All around, yet so elusive. Yeah. If we don't reach out for love, 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 oh, we're all just wasting time. Oh, precious time, when in the long run, what's meant to be will be. Those things we ask for become our destiny. But our souls cannot be free eventually. All we will come to see to find the path of the right love. Oh, yeah. Oh, the path of the right love. Ooh, ooh, the path of the right love. Oh, yeah, yeah. The path of the right love. Oh, must surely be good, must surely be kind. And that love, 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 sweet love is meant to be yours, is meant to be mine. And I do believe if we share this life, we must also share all its pain and strife to find the path of the right love. Oh, path of the right love, to find the path of the one love. Ooh, yeah, the path of the right love, the path of the right love. Oh, the path of the right love. Ooh, the path of the right love, the path of the right love, the path of the right love. Path of the right love. Alrighty, so this next tune, this is not my tune. However, it has something very important in my heart. When I, from very much of my life, all of my life, until I was 18, I am now 20, I said that I did not sing, which is attributed to a lot of things, but one of them was fear, and one of them was coming across that aha moment. When that happened, my family was very happy, and I don't consider myself a vocalist. I really don't, because I have so much respect for the art and so much to learn about it. However, I was given the amazing opportunity of being able to perform at the Hollywood Bowl, which is an institution for the greatest acts that have been able to perform, and I am extremely lucky to have been able to do so. And you know, there's a song by Connie Francis called Where the Boys Are, so I'm about to perform for you. But my mom covered that tune, and growing up, I just listened to a lot of 50s music. It holds a very important place in my heart. For some reason, this song just always gets to me in a way that makes me remember that feeling, that excitement about music that a lot of us forget along the way. Especially studying at Berkeley, it's very easy to move past the excitement about music, and this tune always just seems to get me excited about it. And ironically, it's harmonically very, very diatonic, very simple, but sometimes the simplest melodies come across the most powerful. So it's called Where the Boys Are. This is not the song. This is the tuning song. So this next tune, we're going to go through this together because brand new, very excited to share with you guys. I want to thank everybody who had to do with getting me to be on the show. I really appreciate it. And also our classes for being an inspiration for me to write something. And I consider writing an extension of everybody who had a piece to do with it. Because without any one of the instrumental pieces, it wouldn't get done. Song is called I Just Want This, parentheses, to be over. And it addresses the topic of continued racism in this world and how we need to not forget about it and keep it a part of our daily thoughts, and I think that it applies, the chorus, I just want it to be over, I think it applies to so many things. This was just a focus of mine this time because it's been so on my mind recently and in my studies. Hope you guys enjoy it. Forward dreams, made believe, moving on was something we achieved. Come to terms with the absurd, years from freedom yet somehow disturbed. 62, 2015, nugatory numbers in between. When will the jest reveal its sin, equating triumph with the color of our skin? I just want it to be over. I just want it to be through. To be through. Yeah. I just want it to be over. I just want it to be through. To be through. Hey, it's me, family tree. Blue is lighter fluid on my greens. We hide the roots that ground us to this earth. We fear the only predetermined gifts of birth. It's not too late to right the wrongs of fame. Forgetful is the only man to blame. Increase the zoom, let's focus in. Raise your girls to be Martina Luther King. Yeah, and I just want it to be over. I just want it to be through. To be through. I just want it to be over. I just want it to be through. To be through. La 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 la. One for the road?
Yes. Anything you want.
Anything. Wow, putting me on the spot. Okay. Well, might as well. Bed I Made. It's tuned by Oh, we're on a break? Oh, we're not on a break. Oh, okay. So I'll do a tune called Bed I Made. It's by one of my favorite artists, Alan Stone. And I think that every song that I've done somehow aspects me as an artist as a whole, whether it be inspiration or, you know, aha moments or whatnot. This tune is an artist that really inspired me. So it's called Bed I Made. It goes like this. Yeah. Cool?
Yeah.
All right. To complain over the stars, it didn't get me very far. Cause all my problems, they follow me. And I flew to the moon, but it wasn't far enough away from you. Cause all my problems, they follow me. And every night I close my eyes, all my troubles fade, yeah. Every morning when I rise, I'm just sleeping in this bed I made. 1 million times inside of my mind. Oh, I have justified, baby, but all my problems, they follow me. And I discovered a way to cleverly avoid the blame. But all my problems, they follow me. Close my eyes and all my troubles fade. Every morning when and then I rise, I'm just sleeping in this bed I made. I can't outrun the pain. Should've chased these demons as they came. And what I would to trade, oh, to make them in this bed I made. Yeah. 'Cause every night I close my eyes, all my trouble bubbles fade. Every morning when and I rise, I'm just sleep. I'm just sleeping in this bed I made. Yeah.
Well, African accent, as you noticed, takes great pride. Not for the first time, but for a continued future, to bring in first-rate musicians such as Emily Estefan, my own student, for your musical pleasure and also philosophical enlightenment, because she combines into one single whole a synthesis of two talents that she's working on with remarkable flexibility and commitment to her craft, namely music first and philosophy second. Her performance tonight is only a beginning. As you can see, there is tremendous talent that is being worked on. And in the future, if he has time, I intend to bring her again to play the drums for you, because she is originally a drummer, but also a guitarist. This has been your host, Theodoros Kyros, for African Accent.